All right, well, thank you. I am, as mentioned, I'm Jennifer Klein with the Georgia's Coastal Management Program, funded through NOAA, the Coastal Zone Management Act. We are housed within our state's Department of Natural Resources, and one objective of our program is to provide technical assistance to local governments, act as a liaison to federal and other state agencies, and to foster the transfer of science to management. In particularly, my focus is in the realm of coastal hazards for those. A little bit about us, because some people don't necessarily always realize that Georgia has a coast, but we do. We focus our area in the 11 coastal counties of Georgia. We have 6 that are ocean-facing counties, and then we have 5 that we call coastal inland. They are tidally influenced counties. Here in coastal Georgia, we have a 6 to 9 foot tidal range. We have 100 miles of beaches, shoreline beaches, and over 380,000 acres of salt marsh. We experience a wide range of hazards, and one important note for that in this project that I'm going to be explaining is that here in coastal Georgia, we have not had a direct hit by a hurricane since 1898, and that is the image that you're seeing on the screen is the city of Brunswick, where our office here is located after the hurricane of 1898 with some significant storm surge. A little bit about our project that I want to tell you about using some of our science to management through this process. Back about 6 years ago, as being a part of the Governor's South Atlantic Alliance at the time here, we became interested in Florida's disaster redevelopment planning process, just kind of through our partnership with these similar states, and we and how you can incorporate a lot of this into other of our other local and state plans. So we kind of attempted to kind of look at recovery and redevelopment, where major disasters have increased in magnitude and frequency in recent years, causing unprecedented damage. And as the extent of damage has increased, so too has the cost of recovery and redevelopment. The inflated cost of recovery and redevelopment is caused in part by neglected infrastructure, rapid urbanization, and concentrated high-value property development along vulnerable coastlines. By addressing the challenges of recovery and redevelopment prior to a disaster recurring, jurisdictions are able to maneuver complicated legal and political processes quickly and effectively. Due to the effect it has on the community's resilience, communities across the nation have recognized the value of implementing recovery and redevelopment strategies before disaster. And when we talk about the recovery, it's anywhere from, say, 6 months after a disaster to even 50 years out into the future or longer. So what we did through our enhancement project to NOAA, we looked at a strategy that would allow us to address recovery and redevelopment planning at the state level in Georgia and at the local levels. And because we are a coastal management program, we could do that in our coastal zone. So in 2013, with our input and the assistance of our state emergency management agency, our governor signed an executive order for our two agencies to work collectively on a state disaster recovery and redevelopment plan, and to also take that to our coastal communities. So we did 2 pilot communities. We selected Chatham County and the city of Savannah. That's our more urban, ocean-facing community to develop a recovery and redevelopment plan. And then we also looked at Brantley County, which is one of our more rural communities. It's a coastal inland community with a population of about 20,000 people, much different capacities, different vulnerabilities. And we did a disaster recovery and redevelopment plan for them as well. These plans were to be consistent with FEMA's National Disaster Recovery Framework, which was released in 2011. That kind of sets guidance for planning, looking at multiple areas, so community planning, economic recovery, health and social services, infrastructure, natural and cultural resources, volunteers and such. So it's a very holistic planning that requires the whole community to get involved. On these projects, we also require that they include science, looking at local sea level rise predictions and shoreline change rates as a vulnerability, which a lot of times FEMA doesn't necessarily always look at those since they are not actual events. They're not considered hazards that are looked at a lot of times in, say, hazard mitigation planning. So we wanted through this process, especially looking at redevelopment, to consider some of these impacts that we will see in the future. These hotspots were determined for all of our coastal counties through a contracted project with Georgia Southern University, and we were able to give very localized data to the communities when doing their planning. Once these projects were completed, we developed a guidance document. It's the Post-Disaster Recovery and Redevelopment Plan, a guide for Georgia communities. So it's not necessarily just how to, but it's how did these two communities do this. What works for a urban community may not work for a rural community, and so how did they adapt differently? Who were the stakeholders that they brought to the table? What suggestions would they have if they had to do it again? And so that was published last year in the middle of hurricane season, which was perfect for us. And then we were fortunate to be a part of the Southeast Disaster Recovery Partnership in the middle of this entire project. If you're not familiar, the Southeast Disaster Recovery Partnership is a multi-state initiative whose mission is to increase capacity for long-term disaster recovery through effective planning and partnerships. Across the public and private sectors, which is important, having that private sector be involved. And this is achieved through initiatives designed and implemented at the state and local level and through building relationships among emergency management, natural resource management, planning and business continuity across the Southeast. It is currently funded by NOAA's Regional Coastal Resilient Grant Program, and we were able to partner with them for our next step in our project as a co-PI to the Regional Resilient Grant. We got some funding through the Disaster Partnership to take our next step, which is to look at the next community, which was our Glynn County, which is kind of where we are located, where our office is currently located on the coast, and to do another disaster recovery and redevelopment plan with the county and its jurisdictions. The difference with this piece of the project is that in the midst of doing this project, we had Hurricane Matthew, which was an opportunity for us because we haven't been impacted by a hurricane in a really long time. We have a very complacent coast here. A lot of people don't feel that they can get impacted by a hurricane, and so this really allowed us to see where some of our gaps are and our needs are. Some of the opportunities that we, or some of the issues that we found were coming with marine debris. You know, who's going to clean up the marine debris? If it's not Coast Guard, then who? And how do we determine what was there before versus after for that FEMA reimbursement? As well as our local governments had some issues with just debris removal in general, and we haven't really had those issues before without having some of these problems. And then the biggest issue that we learned were communications. We had a lot of communication breakdown and failure. And so this opportunity allowed us in the middle of this process to kind of incorporate that into the local government's disaster recovery and redevelopment plan so we can have a little bit more robust planning as we're moving ahead with this. The other cool part of this project is we had a little bit of extra funds to give to the local to develop to the Joint Water and Sewer Commission to take some money and do a climate resilience adaptation plan and strategy. So we have, obviously, we have a lot of issues with some of the nuisance flooding that you've heard talked about. And how can we actually adapt some of that infrastructure to its vulnerabilities? And so we did we used EPA's CREAT tool and determined where some of those infrastructure vulnerabilities are and how they might be able to adapt. And then the Water and Sewer Commission was able to kind of take some of those issues and prioritize their capital improvement plans based on some of those vulnerabilities. So that was a pretty big step, I think, for us and for this area. And then some of our next steps that we will be doing, we are starting, we have our Charlton County. I'm sure you have all heard about the Okefenokee wildfires, and that is Charlton County. So we will be starting their disaster recovery and redevelopment plan this summer. Very timely. It will be right in the forefront of their minds, so it will be a great opportunity for us to capitalize on that. We are also starting tomorrow a small business disaster recovery and redevelopment plan. Are partnering with our state economic development authority and our state chamber of commerce office to help work on that and provide input through the stakeholders. And then we will be starting our fifth disaster recovery and redevelopment plan in October. And then also in October, we'll begin a three-year process to complete disaster recovery and redevelopment plans for our remaining six coastal counties, which will allow us to be the first state to have a completed resilient coast based on FEMA's National Disaster Recovery Framework. And at the end, we will be hosting a two-day disaster resiliency conference, which we hope to go ahead and get started planning on that. And that is all that I have.